and she's now the Hubble Fellow at Space Telescope. And today she's going to talk to us about the evolution of massive stars.
Thank you. Thank you for having the chance to visit the Hubble and experience in its real temperatures. Yeah, so I came from Utrecht University, and there was a place that's very strong in stellar evolution, stellar winds. I didn't know you were supposed to work on exoplanets or cosmology, so that's what I started in. And it's stellar evolution. It's not a sexy topic, but I would like to show you a few things that are going on in my field that are developments that might affect a few other fields. Fields in which you may use stellar models that you can download, for example, from the Geneva Group. You can plug up the shells, and these models are the classic models, and they're widely used, but there's a few developments that make us think that stars evolve differently, and that might have more implications. So I just want to give you an example of those. So I came from Utrecht University. It no longer has an astronomy department. Martin left well in time, also me. They closed it just after I left. I had nothing to do with it, but fortunately all the people there went to the other departments in the Netherlands, so they're still working on stars. So let me introduce massive stars a little bit and motivate you. Oh, I want to say other thing. There's a few other interests I have, and I'm here for 2 days, and I would love to talk to some of you more and interact. And I wanted to mention a few things that I can't put in this talk. So I'm quite interested in globular clusters and abundance patterns in globular clusters and multiple populations. Another thing, I'm interested in metal poor stars and the halo and the chemical signatures in there. Mostly what binaries can do to mix things up. I have some interest in the formation of X-ray binaries. I'll show one aspect that's passing by in this talk. And supernova progenitors as well. Today, I will focus on rotation, stellar rotation, and the origins and the causes and the consequences of rotation. But let me introduce massive stars. Massive stars play a large role in the universe. They live very short. There's not many of them, but they do quite a lot of damage in those short lives. And they play two roles in the universe, I would say, that we can use as astronomers. One is more an active role, the role in which you could tell, speak of them as cosmic engines, in which they enrich the universe in all the chemical elements, in which they provide the energy, in which they drive the outflows of galaxies, and in which they disturb the ISF. On the other side, there's more the passive role. They provide us with tools to study objects in the distant universe, because they're pretty bright, especially if they're in groups of them. So they dominate the light of distant star-forming galaxies, and especially when they explode, we can see the polar distances. Supernovae, there's a few very bright supernovae. There is claims for a superluminous supernova, potentially a bright stability supernova, which is now seen at redshift. I think the redshift is around 4. That is just a few months ago. And there's long gamma ray bursts that have been said to detect out to redshift 8.2. So we're spending quite a phase. But to put this more in physical terms, on the energy part, I'm interested in the feedback, the chemical feedback, the mechanical feedback, and the radiative feedback of them. And on the probe side, I think massive stars are interesting to probe things like what is the initial mass function of stars in the distant universe, and is that changing in time? Deriving how the star formation rate changes over time in distant galaxies. And can we see signatures of these first stars through the explosion? This is not necessarily the things I will talk about, but this is the context you should keep in mind when I'm giving you a few of the gory details of these models. And these are all the areas, I think, where it's interesting to explore the effects. So let's discuss a little bit. Stellar evolution is a topic that was solved last century somewhere. But I want to raise the question, how well do you understand how these stars evolve towards their death and what they do in the meantime? So this is the picture we show to our students, or even in a public talk, on how massive stars live their life. They go through different stages. There's the star formation stage. They live a long time on the main sequence, just burning hydrogen, very boring stage. They swell up, explode eventually, leave a compact object behind, and maybe some of the material becomes part of a new generation of stars. So let me ask you one question. Which phase in this diagram is the best understood phase? Or the simplest phase?
Obviously.
What a bit of a rhetorical question, but well, the main secret is clearly, I think, for many people, we tend to think of that as the simplest phrase.
The black hole.
The black hole. Yeah, that's, yeah, that's, yeah, that's, yeah. Okay, I was hoping you went for main sequence because I want to, that's my connection to my next slide. So, this is of course a diagram we use all the time to look at our stellar models and look at their properties, which is the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, which is plotting the luminosity of the stars, how bright they are, versus the effect of temperature or their colors. And this is where our classic models predict where all the stars should lie on the main sequence. So I marked it here in this gray area. Do you have a pointer actually? So there's different stellar models in here that come from. So I plotted models for different massive stars, and for me, a massive star is anything that is massive enough that it actually evolves. So usually, my interest start around 1.5, so it's a little bit more massive than the sun. Typically, we talk about massive stars when they can explode at the end of their life as a core collapse supernova. So above 8 solar masses. So these are tracks for a 10 solar mass star up to a 40 solar mass star, and these lines show how they evolve as they burn through their elements. And this is the part, the main sequence, if they burn hydrogen, it's very slow, and afterwards their evolution accelerates, as you probably got somewhere in class at some point. So for each star in this diagram, for each star in this area of the diagram, there should be 100 to 1,000 stars in this gray matter. And the prediction of these models is this is very densely filled, very dense on this side, and it drops off. And then there's a very steep drop off, and there's almost no star. That is the prediction behind these models. So let me show you an observed sample here. This is a specific observed sample that is coming from a collaboration that I'm involved in, which is using a VLT, the Very Large Telescope, ESO telescope. To take spectra of different stars. I could show you this for many samples. It has been done also in color magnitude diagrams, and this is the theoretical diagram. What I'm showing here is a very generic problem. It doesn't have to do with the sample. And the problem is the following. For each star here, there should be 100 to 1,000 stars in this spectrum, which is clearly not the case. So, the point I try to make, we don't even understand the main sequence of massive stars. We don't know whether these stars are part of the main sequence and burning hydrogen, or alternatively, that these stars are actually burning helium, because there is a possibility that these tracks go all the way to its supergiant fringe and then come back to the loop and burn helium here. Or there's a third option. I don't know if you remember what the progenitor of 87A looked like. But that's a blue supergiant. That's what we're talking about. These guys are blue supergiants. I don't know exactly where it lies, but the progenitor of 87A lies somewhere in this area that is not explained by the models. So for these guys, we don't know whether they're burning hydrogen or burning helium or about to explode, which is a pretty embarrassing status, I think, after how many decades of stellar evolution? So this is in the top end. And the low mass end, I think we understand the width of the main sequence much better. There we have problems because we start to look at these stars in so much detail that we start to worry about oscillations and all kind of diffusion patterns and chemical patterns.
Yes, please. These stars all rotate very fast. How much of this measurement could be due to the fact that you're looking at the gravity darkening?
That's very well within this. There's other effects of rotation that I'll show you in a minute that are very big, but we'll talk about it. The gravity darkening effect is a small effect because it does a lot of things to the star, but the gravity darkening effect is only a lot if the star is really close to breakup at the maximum speed. And whatever angle you look at, there's a really big difference between the temperature and the pole on the equator. But whatever angle you look at, you always see the integrated flux of the star. So whatever angle you look at, most of the light is coming from the intermediate latitude. And it is a small effect in the end. There's other effects that will be big, but I'll try to make it more. The models that are widely used in many applications, whether you are interested in a distant galaxy or in the feedback of a massive star, or maybe the feedback of a massive star or a star-forming region, it is typically the Geneva models we take, which is are publicly available, and they have these kind of discrepancies if you look at nearby observations. So that's part of the motivation. I want to show a little bit of background. I'm one of the people doing stellar models, as you might understand by now, but I'm closely involved in quite a few observing programs. So one of them is, I already showed some data from that, is a program in to look at LMC. And the LMC hosts this starburst region, 30 Dorades, which is the nearest starburst that we can observe. It's a bit of a baby starburst, but it's the nearest starburst where we can actually see the stars individually, at least most of them. Sometimes there's still two or three stars at the same time in your fiber. So in this area, for the first time, there is a large survey, which is for stellar purposes very large, for massive stellar purposes very large, of 1,000 massive stars that have been observed multiple times, taking spectroscopy. And for these 1,000 stars, we know whether they rotate. We know, the spectra are still being analyzed, but we will know how fast they rotate, what their surface abundances are, what their stellar winds are, and we have a very good handle on whether they have a binary companion, because we observed them 7 times. We might still miss some binary companions, but for the first time we have a very systematic sample.
And what's the mass ratio?
Certainly not 0.2 would be at best. Might be slightly worse for this survey, quoting from another survey. So that's fields in astronomy, where we think of samples of 100,000 or maybe a million galaxies, SDSS. This is the largest survey that we have in our field, and that's what we have to deal with. And we cannot go much larger. It's too hard to find these massive stars. To do it in our own galaxy, they're all hidden, and we don't know the distances. And there's a lot of trouble. So this is 1,000. Of those, there's 300 O stars. We could maybe, at best, go up by a factor of, by one order of magnitude, if we really had an amazing proposal and got an amazing amount of time, but it's still stars, it's not sexy. So, 2 orders of magnitude if we would really push it. But that's all we can do nearby. After that, we need new facilities. Anyway, I think this survey is going to give us a lot of new insight. It's still ongoing. And I just wanted to point out this region. This is a very exciting region because it's breaking almost every record we have in stellar in our field. So just it's a pity we don't have a. This is a beautiful image. You would see it for real. But so in this area there's a cluster R136. We'll just fall asleep a bit. Why don't we leave the light on? So this is a cluster, and before we could observe it, and there were claims that this was 1,000 Solomon stars for a while. Well, that clearly is not the case. There's many, many stars. Maybe 10 to the 5 stars, something like that. 10 to the 4 at least. So there are claims that there are stars in here, at least 3 or 4, that have masses around 200 solar masses or more. Probably more. So the estimate is that they are that if they were single stars, that they were born with masses around 500 solar masses. I don't know if you're feeling for this, but typically, in your stellar evolution class, this is a simple estimate, and you come up with sort of a maximum stellar mass around 100. There's no real physical reason why there should be an upper mass limit. It's just getting harder and harder for these stars to be stable. But we have no problem in the stellar evolution cone to make a star of a million solar mass. The question is, how would you get all that mass in a stellar construction in the first place? But if you would have it, it would be principally stable. We don't have a clear reason why there would be an upper limit. But these stars definitely exceed what we kind of empirically thought was the upper limit of around 100. And they're 200, 300 solar masses.
Including a possible limit to be binaries?
Who's talking to be an author? Yeah. You don't get far away from it. So there's big error bars on this. We think that they're not close binaries because we looked 7 times at intervals that are logarithmically spaced. And we would have detected with 99% probability if they were so close, 90% probability if they're so close. They could be still wider, but it's very hard to get away from this. They're going to be very massive. What is more important is that we don't understand the atmospheres of these stars, and the mass estimate comes from getting their luminosity, and you have to get their volumetric luminosity for this. So that there is a very big uncertainty there, but And that's the main reason. I think they tried to get it into science, and I think it's the main reason why it was not posted that strongly. But it's very interesting result, I think. There's other records in this area. So this is a very dense star cluster. There's all kind of collisions or near collisions going on between these stars. And once in a while, there's a binary star and a triple star that might shoot something out of the cluster. And we think that might have happened because over here, I forgot which one it is, there's an 80 solar star, also one of the most massive beasts we have in here. And it's actually flying towards us with a velocity that is, I think it's 2 sigma away from the average of the other velocity. It's flying towards us. We don't know the velocity in the plane. If it came from there, of course, it should have a velocity away from it. And that's why what I show in the background is an HST image that was taken last year. And next year, we'll take this one again. And we have proper motion and astrometry experts. And we will be able to detect the velocity of this star to an accuracy that will be enough to determine whether it's really flying out from that cluster. And I think it's very important to do, because if such massive stars are formed there by themselves alone, it's quite different from them forming in a low carbon. There's another record that was broken that we published last year. Somewhere here, we have the record holder fast rotating stars. It was the fastest rotator. It's very close to its maximum rotation rate. And the velocity at the equator is at least 500 kilometers a second. And the highest we had by then was around 350 or so. So it was actually, we broke that record somewhere else in this region already. But this one was a very exciting one, because this is a supernova remnant here. There's a very energetic pulsar spinning here. And we got very excited because we thought these two maybe were part once of one binary system. I don't believe it anymore, but it was a good story. This is still the fastest rotating star, but I don't really want to go into too much detail. Just, I guess I was advertising this when I gave this talk elsewhere, where people were very interested in the data that's being added to this survey. So what I showed in the background is on one color, but last year, Elena Sabi at Space Telescope got time to have a treasury program and add different colors to it. So this is one of the tiles of that other image. And what she will be able to do with this is really go over this, look at all these pre-made sequence stars, find if the IMF is differing throughout this region, find how the age of these pre-made sequences are distributed, is star formation triggering, are the differences from those that are close to the massive stars and further away from the massive stars. So there's a lot of data that is coming with this. But that's more of a side for me. So let's talk about rotation. Is there a... So rotation. So this is the artist impression that they made for this fastest rotating star. And this is what we think sort of looks like. So the star is a little bit deformed. You already mentioned this, the star is a little bit deformed, it's slightly flattened. It's probably a bit hotter at the pole and cooler at the equator. And maybe it's shedding material into a disk. I don't think the disk would look like this, but oh yeah. And apparently, if you have a press release and it needs to be exciting, then every star needs to have a planet. But that seems very unlikely to me. This guy is probably traveling away from wherever it was born, and it would be pretty hard for it to take a planet along. It would be interesting to think whether planets could form in these disks, but that's a different story.
Does it have any magnetic
field? This one not, but yeah, I told you about it. That's a different one. We don't know actually for this one.
What's the other bound?
This is an LMC they can measure here. We have similar things in the galaxy where we can do it. And this type of objects have no magnetic fields. There's another very interesting one that you would like, but that's a different story. So the distribution of rotation rates for this survey, a subset of the survey actually, because it's still being analyzed. This is the rotation rates of stars between 8 and 25 solar masses, the B-type stars. So it's not the most massive ones yet. We were having them in preparation. And what I show you is the distribution of the projected rotational velocities. You get this from the broadening of the lines. So this is a funny shape. This is clearly a bimodal distribution. It is a very young region. So if I see this, there's two questions that I have. Why? What is the origin? Why are these two peaks there? Is this reflecting maybe two modes in which stars form? Or is this reflecting something that happens during the early evolution of stars that later leads to this bimodal construction? So is it the nature of the stars or their nurture? Sorry for overusing that term, but so the other question I have and I would like to address is, well, these are really high rotation rates going up to almost breakup. If the star's rotating that fast, it's affecting the structure. So what are the consequences of these rotation rates? Because in the classic stellar model, this rotation is not accounted for. So I'm going to show you, I'm going to do this in reverse order. I will very briefly show you one of the extreme effects of rotation without going into too much detail, and then I will go back to the origin and talk more about minors. So these are a few more stellar tracks. As I showed you before, luminosity versus effective temperature. Here we go from 16 solar masses to 60 solar masses now. And stars start here when they're born, after they ignite hydrogen, if we skip the whole star formation process, which magically I assume to be happening. So they start there, they burn hydrogen, and they convert their interior into helium. They form a core and an envelope, and the envelope expands, and these stars become red supergiants, eventually, most of them. So this is what happens in our models for slow rotation, which is very similar to what you find in any textbook. So for rapid rotators, there are instabilities being triggered in these stars. So one of the instabilities is that these stars get slightly flattened, not much, but slightly, but it's enough to create an imbalance in the temperature that is on an equipotential surface inside the star, and this triggers an instability which triggers a large-scale meridional circulation. And that's very interesting because normally these stars have a core and an envelope, but the envelope is radiatively stable. So there's no way for a star to have elements that are produced in the center to show up at the surface, unless at a very late stage you strip the surface. But now suddenly there's this transport process inside the star that can grab elements from the center and bring it to the surface. So you can see abundances like nitrogen, because nitrogen is something that piles up during hydrogen burning, you can start seeing it at the surface.
So what's being done in terms of the replenishing of hydrogen in the core by this circulation? Because so
basically it will come.
It will come. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. So if you mix a little bit, then it's just a bit of nitrogen out. If you're very fast rotating, and I'll show you them in a minute, you start to mix hydrogen inwards and helium outwards. So the other way of mixing would be shear mixing. As different layers have so much shear, if there's a lot of shear, you can turn over little eddies, and it would be the other way to transport processes. But if you transport helium from the center outwards, then this picture of a core and an envelope starting to have problems.
Because you still don't know with phenomenological models. Nobody's technically 3D hydro calculation.
But they do, but so we're talking about nuclear timescales here.
Exactly.
So that's
long.
Well, that's very long.
The Edison-Sweet time scale, it's really that of the rotating, is basically the Kelvin time.
Yeah, even that is very long. So
that's much shorter than what it's dark, right?
That's true, but it's much longer than the hydrodynamical time scales that you can cover in these hydrogens.
Oh, sure.
So, yeah. We do 1D models, and we won't be doing that for a decade more, for sure. But we need to do both things at the same time, but time scales I'm interested in, we're not going to do that in 3D anyway. So let me show you what rotation can do. So you know stars, if they evolve, they expand and become more luminous roughly during their life. And they move to the upper right of the diagram. That's what we all know. So let me show you what rotation does. These are very fast rotating models, and I show you on purpose our most extreme models, so you will remember that rotation can do a lot. These stars evolve the wrong way in the HR diagram. And I'll simply go over this cartoon picture so you have sort of an understanding why this is. So these stars also start burning hydrogen here at roughly the same spot. They're not that different when they start. They're slightly different. You can see this red track, this 30 solar mass star, this blue track. They're starting almost at the same point, only the rotating stars is a little bit cooler and a little bit bigger actually. That's just the effect that rotation helps to support the star by the centrifugal acceleration. That's all. And I should say this 1D models, but what I'm showing here is the temperature at an average latitude. So to come back to the question I had before, if you would look at the board, you created a small deviations here. It is very fast rotating. It's actually pretty small if you have the take the integrated. If you would take the integrated line and think what is the effective temperature that sort of characterizes. So they start here. They move up because they convert hydrogen into helium. They get more compact. But this time, there is no core envelope structure formed, but the whole star effectively is being converted into helium. And it's just easier to have helium being compact in a smaller area. So these stars, they shrink, they become more luminous, and around this time, they run out of all the hydrogen left in the center, so there's no burning source anymore. And the only thing that star can do is contract. And that's the very same thing that happens here. These stars burn hydrogen in the center. At this point, there's no hydrogen in the center anymore, and they contract until hydrogen outward in the shell can provide the next burning source. But the same thing is happening here. These stars contract. You see, our models have some numerical difficulties here. There might be real instabilities in these stars, but we have we try to suppress those. So this is, I should have taken it out. But it's, I guess I left it in to show you that this is not something easy to do. We cannot just set up this grid, run these models, and go away. There's things we need to do.
Is that because of the rotation still at that point? Or is it because I thought a pure helium star one can just make it a model and it evolves fine?
That's fine. Yeah, that's fine. That's absolutely fine. What is one of the challenges? Rotation is not the main challenge. One of the challenges is these are so luminous, they're close to the Eddington limit, and they get very funny density inversions at the surface, which are really a pain to deal with, and where all your mesh points want to do nasty things. I don't know what. But these guys, it's not as strongly as I pictured in the cartoon. They're not completely converted into helium. This one contracts, and here, the outer layers become hot enough to have a tiny bit of hydrogen that is somewhere left in the outer layer still ignite for a bit. And they make this hook, this backward turn, and that's exactly the same as this. But very soon they have nothing left anymore, they just contract and get hotter.
So doesn't this actually make it look like you have more stars in the
So this is not the helium main sequence. The helium main sequence is off scale here?
Yes and no. Sorry, this is the question. Let me first answer this. So the I'm showing here what we call the temperature. Okay, so in stellar models, the surface of our star, for these stars, might be well inside thick wind. Mm-hmm. So the real helium main sequence in our models is indeed a little bit, I think it's a little bit to the left still, because these guys are not yet very helium. These stars, however, would appear quite a bit cooler because there is this very thick wind, which makes the photosphere move outward. So the observed helium main sequence. So you were asking something as well.
So does this actually make it look like you have more stars in the main sequence of these very rapidly rotating stars?
If you're wondering whether this solves the previous question.
It makes it worse, right?
It just makes it worse. This is not a problem because this should be very rare.
That rapidly rotating.
These so rapidly rotating. These are born breakup, basically. Not breakup in the sense they would break up, but breakup in the sense of close to the capillary limits.
And then as they get more compact.
That depends on the mass loss that's happening at the same time. If there's no mass loss, then it depends on how the moment of inertia changes. A star can expand and get closer to breakup. For these guys, I never plotted it, but I thought about it a lot at the lower mass end, but that's a fun question. Let me think about that later. So one of the reasons why we are interested in this is these guys. We think this is the most viable model to produce the progenitor of a long gamma ray burst. Because for a gamma ray burst, you need a jet to escape from a very compact star that has no hydrogen anymore, and that is very fast rotating to produce the engine. So this is not my area of expertise, but this is one of the ways that we can make the progenitors. And well, I'm not so sure about the magnetar story, but we would really like to know whether this is happening for real or just a quirk that is coming out of the models. So one of the aims of this big survey is based on these models, among those 1,000 stars, there should be between 1 and 3 doing this. It's an annoying number, 1 and 3. We might find one, and then it might be a fluke, but...
What sort of masses do you think this can happen?
Roughly the range that I plot here. If you go too massive, these guys lose have so strong winds that they lose angular momentum in the winds. If you go too low, these stars, they need to be massive enough and luminous enough so that the radiation pressure inside the star is strong. So these stars are close to instability anyway, so a bit of rotation easily mixes them over. Here these stars are so stable, we don't think it's happening, although actually that is this boundary is governed by a free parameter that we haven't been able to calculate yet. So the predictive power of these models is very small, but it's a lot of fun to explore what kind of physics can happen in principle. So that's and I think this is one of the reasons why I tend to try to be involved in these observing programs, because otherwise we just fool ourselves and get lost in all these funny tracks that we have.
Do you put any spin down effects? So you mentioned magnetic wind break, but did it continue spinning at this rate for other?
So there's a little trick, which you can probably not see on the back there, but here's a tiny number, which says Z. The metallicity is, these are relatively low metallicity. So these are, this is for stars in the SMC. They have reduced winds. I could show you the what it looks like for the galaxy. And the galaxy, the winds are so strong that the stars spin down. And we see a little bit of these effects, but it's not that strong.
So and in the LMC?
I'll show you the plots later, but it's intermediate behavior. So these guys don't do it anymore. These guys still do it. It's narrowing the window in which you can for multiple reasons. But I'd rather spend a little bit of time talking about binarity, actually, in the fact that, although this is exciting. But it's, this is what I'm talking about. So two stars in a binary system, they don't live their life undisturbed. At some point, one star will expand, and it will overfill its what we call its Rorschach slope, and it will probably transfer mass to the secondary star. And then the secondary star is accreting the mass, but it's also accreting the angular momentum. So this star starts spinning. So this story of binarity and the story I told you before are going to be related stories in the book. So one of the things I worked on together with an observer, Huxana, in Amsterdam, is on his efforts to get new constraints on how often these stars are in binaries. And this is something like trying to determine the IMF, the initial mass fraction of stars. But it's much more important because the consequences are not. So what is the binary fractions of these stars? What is the mass ratios of these stars? And what is the separations of these stars? And that will set how a stellar population will evolve. And the effects are much larger than the tiny bit of slope of freedom that we have in that. So if a massive star appears to be single, if you found one, then you probably didn't look hard enough, because all these massive stars come with companions. And sometimes you can actually observationally resolve them, but almost for these massive stars, almost all the times you find companions are so close that you actually see the effects on the orbit. Unless you're so unlucky that, of course, your binary is oriented in this way, you're not going to see any double shift in this way. But if you have a massive star and you convince yourself for some reason that it's really a single star, then you should still be very careful using it to calibrate your single stellar models, because there's a good chance that it used to be a binary in the past. Because there's so many close binaries, they may merge. And they may merge somewhere early in the evolution, and there might be funny effects of that you might misinterpret. So they might merge, or they might be the secondary star that has spun up and then the binary broke up. Or that the companion is so far away, so low mass, that it's very hard to detect. So,
let's go to the statistics of this now. It's always been a real struggle to actually nail this.
I'm going to show you the next slide, I think.
So let me put the question another way. As stars evolve towards supernovae, I'm saying that
this is exactly the next slide.
If I didn't answer your question in the next slide, then ask me again. Okay? So these are the two things I want to talk about. I will show some statistics, because Huxana is the one who did look very hard in nearby clusters. And then the second part, I will discuss a bit more these stars that are products of binary evolution. You might be mistaken. So what Huck did is he went after a few nearby clusters and that are rich in O stars, and he observed every one of them to death. So we know whether they're binaries as long as the orbit is remotely in a favorable inclination. We have all the stars in there, so it's complete. And he took so many observations that he doesn't only know whether it's a binary, but he also got solutions for the orbital period of these systems and in the mass ratio for almost all of them, for 80 or 90%. So at the moment, this is the most complete sample that we have for O stars, for massive stars above 60 solar masses or so, on the characteristics of their binary formation. And this is based on young star clusters that are around 2 to 4 million years old. And we're not going to see anything younger than that and do statistics on them. This is also the closest we can get to what the initial conditions are when these stars are formed. So what I'm showing here is a part of the data. I'm showing the distribution of orbital periods that come out of it. So in this sample, there's 71 objects that might be single, binaries, multiples.
Where are these? Not where are they?
It's Milky Way, but it's a few clusters whose names I forgot. But within 2 kilometers. Yes, on Milky Way. 71 objects that appear to be at least one O star, but it turns out that at least 30 of them had a second O star circling them, and quite a few more of them have maybe a B-type star or a lower mass star circling. So here I show you the orbital periods ranging from 1 day to about 10,000 days, and so it's a cumulative distribution. So you see there's a lot of them with orbital periods less than about 10 days, and then it flattens off. That's what you expect, because the wider they are, the harder they are to detect. And even though we observe them to death, you still will be missing some. So, but for the first time, this sample is so well understood that you can model the selection effects. So what he did, he chose underlying distribution functions and did Monte Carlo simulations to try to simulate his observational strategy again and try to reproduce the observed distribution. So I think this is giving our best handle on the real binary fraction. You're seeing that's clearly more than half. If you for binaries that are less than 3,000 days and have mass ratios between 0 and 1. So let me tell you a bit more what this is implying. And just to give you a feeling for these numbers, because what is an orbital period in days anyway? So, oh, this shifted a little bit. So around 1,500 days is maybe a good number to keep in mind for a massive star that is telling you if it's wider than that, could still interact, but it's not doing that much damage. If it's shorter than that, there will be so much damage to one of the stars that by the time it explodes, it doesn't have its hydrogen envelope anymore. It will be completely stripped. So it took a bit of a conservative boundary there, but and you're seeing that there's more than half of the objects already. And so the other new thing that's coming out of this survey is that we used to think that the real distribution was a flat distribution here, but there's a much stronger preference for these closed systems. And what this means is that these short period systems are so close, they can already interact before the stars leave the main sequence. So this maybe 6 days or so is a rough estimate to keep in mind. Although, if you remember my first plot, we don't really know how big stars get on the main sequence. So this might actually be quite a bit bigger, but okay. So let's take this as a bit of a conservative estimate. There's a really significant fraction of stars that are so close that they will interact so early, and they will affect all the further evolution stages.
What fraction is that?
Let me convert it in one moment. This is in terms of objects, it's a bit annoying, but I'm going to convert it into the number of stars in one second. So these are so close that they will not only affect all the further stages, but there's also a really good chance that these two will merge. These stars are so close, there's two stars. Physically, maybe this is roughly the if you would scale it down, this is by hand, and this separation is a good scale down. These guys try to become about 200 times bigger, both of them. There's not much room for these stars not to coalesce. So if we work this, take these distribution functions, also the distribution of mass ratios, and I convert it into what happens to your average massive star, then using the input from our stellar models, then this pie chart summarizes the statistics that we're talking about. So how important is binarity for the lives of massive stars? Of all massive stars, there's only a minority that lives its life undisturbed. 30% maybe. And they're probably still binaries, and they can still be disturbed by a very low mass binary that I can detect. Or maybe there's a binary that is still, there's a companion out there that is still, they're blowing their winds, and maybe these winds are colliding, and you see x-rays from that. So there's a lot of fun things that can happen here with companions, but they're not being completely stripped. So our stellar models sort of reproduce the evolution of these systems well, I think. Unless we underestimate the very low mass production. The majority of massive stars does not live their life undisturbed. And in principle, the models that we might use in many astrophysical applications don't apply to these. Maybe they're not too bad for some of the applications, I hope, but there are big differences. So there's different things that can happen. Of course, I'm not really sure how to put error bars on the pie chart, but of course all these fractions have error bars. The error bar on, so it's about 70% that will interact, and that's plus or minus 10% if you come from that. That's a small, but you don't get away with the fact that binaries are important. Now, there's different subsets here that are more uncertain because there's model uncertainties here, so there might be room to play a bit here, but that's uncertainty in the models. So one of the things, they may merge. My best estimate is that a quarter of them will merge with their companion. And that is a fairly conservative estimate. The error bar downwards would be towards 20%, and within every reasonable assumption as we know now in our models, it could be this high. I felt a bit, I felt it was controversial enough to put it this way, but we don't have a good reason to prefer any of these. A third of them will be stripped, and they will end their lives as hydrogen poor supernova. And it's roughly the amount of this 1BC supernova that are hydrogen poor. And the people thought about this scenario, of course, but they also think about this massive stars losing winds. And but I think binaries by themselves in numbers can do the.
Does that mainly occur to the binary?
Yeah. The special cases in which you can do it later with the secondary, you have like a compact object that's being stripped by the secondary, but then we're talking about tiny exotic fractions.
Do these merging ones then make these super extreme heavy stars you mentioned earlier?
I am proposing that, but there's strong proof for this is hard. But those massive ones, they're very massive. If you want to make 200 Solomon star, you better merge 200 Solomon stars. I think we need them more than one merges there. That may not be a problem because it's a very dense cluster and stars might collide in the future. There might be multiple merges going.
But for those ones where less than 6 days, do you worry that they're actually touching each other or inside each other during the premium sequence?
Yes, I worry about it a lot. But they form. We see them. I have no idea how you form these. If these would be really premium sequence stars, as we think of low mass stars forming premium sequence, then so the problem I just described to you, these two stars were to become 200 times bigger. The real problem is they were 200 times bigger in the past.
But back then,
Apparently they did, but I don't think, to my knowledge, there's no one having models that really do.
This, of course, is a problem also for lower mass stars.
Sure.
Probably they're triples. The easy answer.
Well, that's for sure. So basically, all of these have a triple companion somewhere out there, which helps at least somewhat with the angular momentum problem going on.
But also to get them there through a cosine mechanisms and things like that.
They almost like they're piling up, though. And there was a separate mechanism.
I mean, with cosine, and you showed us that you can pile them up, right?
No, but I'm saying I don't see an obvious feature there. Well, maybe there is.
Well, there's a break there, right? That depends maybe when they got close.
We should talk about cosine more, but I'm not going to finish this if I start.
This is normal for a theta talk.
Yeah, sure. I just wanted to show you how massive stars live their life. This is just one of them, but the point I'm trying to make is there was no lack of interest in binaries, but we only thought of them for exotic objects, and maybe here for 1H, that's not exotic. We thought of them for X-ray binaries and funny things, but this is how massive stars live their life, almost all of them. And this is a particular one. This is a real stellar model behind this, but this is the ESO artist that converted it into a 3D image, but it's just more fun to show this one. So this more massive star is the one that evolves on a shorter time scale. Will expand and fill its rosso, and it transferred mass, in this case in two phases. The second star stays very blue and it gets rejuvenated, it gets fresh material. it starts to rotate a bit, so you can see it's slightly flattened in this image, and it's still much bluer. The donor star has now almost lost all its hydrogen, and it's going down towards the helium layers, the core, and it's now shrinking, and it's about to burn helium. That doesn't last too long, and it will soon explode as a hydrogen-poor supernova in about an hour. There we go. So this is very likely, in most cases, to break up the system. So this star will travel away, in some cases as a runaway, but that is a special case. In most cases, it will be a slow velocity, and maybe a walk away will be a better description of this. So this will travel away maybe between 30 and 300 parsec from the birth environment, and it will explode as a fairly normal supernova, maybe. Just a type 2 supernova. Maybe there's a bit more rotation in there than what we thought about. But this is how massive stars live their life most. And there's all kind of exotic channels we can think about to explore different systems. I don't know how much time I still have. Okay, so I want to show you a little bit how, at least I'm approaching this problem and trying to work out what the implications are of this. And I'll stick with the theme of rotation. But just so you can appreciate that this is not an easy task. If you do single stars, and if you want to make a grid of single stars and put it on the web so people can go out and use it, I have only in one dimension I need to probe. So every time I showed you models of different masses, 20, 40, 60, 80 solar masses, and I'm basically done. Well, that's not entirely true. Most of these grids also account for different compositions, which is clearly a factor, especially if no metals in the star, the first generation of star evolved quite differently. And what I tried to convince you in the first part of my talk, that rotation is actually a dimension you need to consider. And depending on the rotation rate, the evolutionary tracks might be quite different. Although it's quite bimodal, you could do very fast rotation and non-rotation and you would cover most of the effects. But in principle, you would have a three-dimensional parameter space if you want to cover single stars. Well, you see my problem here. I have a few more dimensions. The separation and the mass ratio are the most important ones. But in principle, the initial eccentricity is also an important part. That turns out not to be the major factor. Playing with the eccentricity can be sort of being hidden in the separation. So I could, if I want to be cheap on computing power, I could leave out the eccentricity for a moment.
Tidal coupling.
Yeah, so yeah, that, yeah.
Because now you link to rotation too, without
how. Yeah, sure. But this is in principle the dimension I should spend, and that's not the whole story. There's huge uncertainties here. This is not at all, we're not talking about a theory from first principles here. There is dirty physics that has three parameters that need to be calibrated, or they need to be explored what the effects are. So I could add a whole other set of dimensions in principle that I would like to explore to know what the effects of these assumptions are. So I cannot, you can approach this in different ways, but I'm approaching this by paying a price, by moving away from the detailed physics, but moving towards codes that are really fast and that allow me to explore the uncertainties. And maybe then I can learn something and bring it back to the detailed models and the other way around. But this is the approach I'm mostly going for. This is based on a code that was developed a while ago, and it's sometimes called the Hurley code. And it's basically a set of single stellar models. Basically, it's a set of tabulated models. And we compute the physics of our binary systems by using these single stellar models as a grid to interpolate and jumping between these. So if a star gains mass, we approximate it by taking other single stellar models. There's people that thought hard about how to do this in a time when computers didn't have much memory. So I didn't use tables, but analytic fits do this, which makes my life a bit complicated, because otherwise I could easily update these models, but that's just technicalities that we can deal with. But so one thing that these codes are used for, and that Martin knows very well, is to produce, make estimates, for example, of type 1a progenitors. So these codes have been mostly used at the lower mass end. It's very dangerous to do this, to make these predictions about these very late stages, because the later the stage, the more uncertain phases you go through. To make a type 1a, there's at least one common envelope phase, and there's a lot of physics we don't understand. And you govern all of that in free parameters. I think I'm a bit more on the safe side, because I'm interested in these main sequence stars for now, or at least the early phases, so I'm staying away from a few of these uncertainties. But I'm introducing a few new ones So one of the things we worked on a lot is improving the massive star physics in this code. So better mass loss recipes. We spent a lot of time on having some sort of treatment of rotation. And there's better fits for the moment of inertia of these stars. And one of the things that was quite interesting was stellar mergers. And we have huge uncertainties and a very poor understanding what happens if two stars merge. But I think you can cover all the uncertainties we have in two main questions. How much mass is lost during a merger, and how much mixing is going on? And these two questions hide a lot of detailed physics. But I can have these two questions and just attach two free parameters to those and see the effect of those. So this is the type of way I'm paying the price for detailed physics, but still try to learn from it by having a code that's fast enough that allows me to explore what happens if these mergers are fully mixed or not mixed at all. That's more of an example. So let's take a rotation. There's many ways in a binary system to spin stars up. And so one of the ways is by tidal interaction. So the most favorable situation would be if the two stars are synchronized with the orbit, and they would always tend to reach that situation. If they're very wide, that would take so long that's not interested. But if they're very close, they would be significantly deformed, and the torques would, in principle, be able to cause this in interesting time scales. For stellar population, this is not the most important effect. How much time?
Just over five minutes.
Okay. I have a little deviation here, but I'm going to skip that one then. So another way is spin up by mass transfer. And the third way is mergers, and I put a question mark there. It's pretty sure that mergers would produce something fast rotating for a bit. But we started to think of, if you have a merger, you have a lot of shear in a very hot plasma. If that generates or amplifies some sort of large-scale magnetic field, then your merger might be fast rotating to begin with, but maybe it spins down very quickly. So mergers are a way to make fast rotating stars. The question is, for how long would they be fast rotating? In a way, that question would also hold for satellites. So quickly, a few examples of this code, of the variety of things that happen in binaries. This is two of the dimensions I'm spanning. So each panel is showing you how fast the stars rotate as a function of time. So the thick lines are the rotational velocities, the equatorial rotational velocities of the stars. And I show you for different binary systems. Here's a 20 solar mass plus a 15 solar mass star in a fairly relatively, not too high orbit, but a 25-day orbit, a much closer orbit. And so without going into the details, there's a lot of examples here of the things I just said. These two panels are for fairly close binaries, and tides play a role. And you see here is the primary star spinning up. But it's because it's expanding, but it's forced to rotate in the same period. If it's expanding, but rotating at the same period, its equatorial rotational velocity goes up. And you see that happening here as well. There's examples of spin-up by mass transfer. There's these used very steep peaks. And that's because you need to transfer a little bit of mass, and you already spin the star up. Stars have a pretty low moment of inertia. You give them a little push, and they already are a breakup. If a star accretes 5% of its own mass from an accretion disk, that's enough to have it at breakup. So between 5 and 10%. And there's even an example of a merger here. So we assume here that mergers are fast rotating. But as I said, I do this for many different assumptions and see what the effects are. But in this particular case, we assumed it was very fast rotating, and it's spinning down after. So using this code, we can now do a little exercise and try to simulate what it does to an entire population. It's a kind of a thought experiment. So I take the stars to rotate with a certain distribution at birth, and I see what happens. But it's not clear what I should take as the initial distribution of rotation rates anymore, because I'm just telling you there's a lot of effects that might play a role. I cannot just take that initial distribution from the observations, for example, because that's what I'm trying to find out. So in this experiment, we start with the simplest distribution I could think of, which is a uniform distribution, and for fairly arbitrary reasons, I cut it off at 200 kilometers a second, so we can easily see what binaries would do to this. So that's the distribution of equatorial velocities. I'm going to show you this in the projected distribution. So just for comparison, this is the initial distribution, but accounting for the fact that stars have different inclination angles. So let me show you what comes out if you assume a population that has continuous star formation. So the simulation, let's say, take the whole galaxy, take every early type star in the galaxy, and you assume that they were formed at all different times, so that's effects of evolution. I'm starting with that, and what comes out? So what I want you to look at is the thick line here, which is the overall distribution. And you see that here's 200 kilometers a second. I have nothing to start with in this population. But there's quite a few stars now that are spinning faster than 200 kilometers a second. And all of them are products from binary interaction. What you can also see here is that single stars are really boring. Single stars here, that's this part of their contribution. It's a small contribution because of the pie chart I showed you earlier. And you also see that the shape of this distribution is almost mimicking the initial shape. It's slightly flatter, and that's because some of the rotating stars, they spin down a little bit, so that slightly changes the shape. But single stars don't do much. They expand a little bit. They lose a little bit of angular momentum through their winds, but that's all. And here's the binary stars. They don't do too much either. But some of them spin up by tides, and the effect is small. And if you can see this, there's a tiny tail here, expanding beyond 200. It's a very small tail. These are the guys that are spun up above 200 kilometers a second. It's a very small effect. So what I want you to take away from this is that for a population of continuous star formation, like early type, all the early type stars in the galaxy, 1 out of 5 of those stars spins rapidly because of binary interaction, or has a high projected rotation. 1 out of 5, and the error bars I would put on this by varying all the physics one by one that I can think of when I have implemented free parameter for, I'm not getting away much from the statement. The variation I get are between 10 and 25%.
So the ones that are spinning rapidly, are they the acceptors of the virtual butterfly?
Yeah, so most of them are the acceptors. So let me blow up this area of this diagram. So I'm showing you what this distribution constitutes. Okay, you see that's actually the binaries have a bimodal part. And you can see here in more detail, most of them are what I call mass gainers, and that's I think what you're referring to, and what you saw in the movie happening as well. Some of them are mergers, but it's a minor contribution. So even if they don't rotate, you still have a lot of fast spinning stars. And some of them are binaries that are still interacting. I'm calling them algos here. It's maybe not the best way to talk about them, but it's systems that are at this moment in a phase of mass transfer. And in that phase, the system is so close still that they are locking, that there's still tides affecting, at least in my models, these are not the most fast rotating stars. So I'm going to wrap up from here. So the main conclusion is you spin up so many stars in binaries that there's not much room for single stars to rotate up. Which means that in star formation, spin down during star formation is even more efficient than we thought already. And you need a lot of spin down to have this huge cloud contracting to one star. There's orders of magnitude of angular momentum you need to lose. But apparently it's more efficient than what we thought. And there's quite a few other implications depending what you're interested in. I'm not going to go over that at this point. But let me wrap up. Where do we go from here? Just as a summary, I talked about rotation and binarity. So the effects of rotation might be very large, but we're not even that sure because these are predictions from the models. And it's not clear whether we're testing these models in the right way. Because if all these rotating stars were spun up in binaries, we might not be comparing the observed stars to the right type of models. So I talked about binaries, and I tried to convince you that the binaries are not only for exotic phenomena, but binaries are the way most massive stars live their lives. So if a massive star appears to be single, the main thing I'm trying to advocate, at least in the stellar community, is be careful because it might have been a binary in the past. So don't expect you can test your single stellar models with it. And so if people really want to test single stellar models, the best way to go is to turn things around, to take a binary. If you have a binary system, it's most likely that the stars haven't done anything yet, that they're still having evolved their life that far as a single star. But what people typically do is, oh, this is a binary, let's kick it out of the sample. That's the wrong thing to do. If you kick those out of the sample, you're only left with all these weird mergers and things. So that's the opposite effect. So if you want a single star, you better find a binary. So So, and just as last part, where do we go from here? I think there's a lot of areas that are interesting to explore, and the effects of rotation and binarity, especially binarity, I think, because that's more proven. And that's both on the role of massive stars as cosmic engines and them as cosmic probes. So there's many questions to be asked. I would like to leave with that.
What were the masses for that last bit you had up there? Did you just use one mass or did you vary the mass? The distribution?
That's, I assume, an whole population. So there's an IMF, of, there's a distribution of masses with the primary star, the secondary star. I don't know how many, I put so many stars in there that there's at least a galaxy. So many stars you don't see the stochastic.
In your movie, you showed when you had the two massive stars, one went supernova and then the other one supernova a bit later. Is there any observational consequence that we can look for to see, like, oh yeah, those two supernovae, we know the two happened and they were from the same system?
We had a sort of discussion like this over lunch, but so one thing to realize is that there's quite a bit of time delay between the two, and there might be quite a bit of spatial difference between the two. There might be. So it's not easy. So one of the things people try to do is look for the progenitors of supernova. So the first one that explodes is what we call 1BC supernova. We haven't seen the progenitors yet. And people are thinking of looking for the Bouverier stars. But maybe we're looking for the wrong thing. Maybe we should look for boring O stars. Because what you would see is not that helium star. It would be completely outshined by the companion. So things we discussed that happened to discuss over lunch is if the first goes up and the second one is still nearby, would you see any signatures of the impact if it's sort of in the line of sight? That's a good question. Yeah.
What's the distribution of helium stars?
Ah, that's hard to do. These things have emission. Well, helium stars for Bouverier stars it's hard because they have this atmospheres and they have broad for a lot. I don't think we have a good answer to this. There's a few people trying to get the distribution of spin stars from these sometimes they have like clumps and you can see the modulation in the photometric periods. That's what people try to do. There might be more work on it than I'm aware of. But I know it's very hard to get it.
Have you looked theoretically what you would expect?
I didn't model that part, but so one of the parts we're really interested in is how does it go with metallicity and low metallicity. And so one of the searches you went into, how strong are these winds of these rock release stars? And we know it nearby, and there I could do what you propose. The real interesting thing would be to do the low metallicity, because there you might be doing the gamma ray bursts. But we don't know how the Bouverier star winds scale with metallicity. So there's a real concern.
So there should be, according to this, pretty strong changes in the stellar populations as a function of age, because of the changes because of the evolution, and also depending on the distribution of binary properties, so that would change from, say, plus to plus to plus to plus. These would all, as well as metallicity. So how much room is there for those sorts of signals?
So I think the age distribution is very important. And if I take age cuts or shoot slightly different star formation histories, I get a pretty different shape in the distribution. So that's why I didn't. You know, I started with the bimodal observed distribution, I ended with the bimodal distribution that I created. We're not there yet to put them next to each other and say this is because of that. And that's because we don't know the age distribution of the stars. And
regardless of the models, you should see significant differences between younger and older.
Okay, so this is the part where binaries complicate things. Because binaries tend to make stars rejuvenate and appear younger than they really are. So these binaries are really messing up our lives of doing that in a simple way.
But I think Chris is saying if you just look at two different clusters, they should be different.
Yeah, that's true.
That's right? That's your statement.
Well,
even if you can't determine the ages, unless you're unlucky.
One of the things we're adding for in this cluster, very dense cluster in the center of 30 degrees, we have now this spectroscopy, and these stars should be young. And there we should have rotation rates that are the closest to the initial rates. Although it's a very extreme environment, so what is it telling us about other environments? But the samples that are out there, it's very hard because people either cut up, kick out binaries, or and if you select the stars near the turn off of the cluster, you're really selecting all these real stars, the mergers and the things that got brighter. So what you propose is exactly what we need to do, but people need to be aware of this when they select the samples before.
So should there be a decline in binary fraction, should go towards the turn off because they merged?
Yes, for instance, if the cluster had a bit of time to evolve.
I think we'll cover the discussion. Take it upstairs for a piece.